All right, good morning, fillies and gentle colts. How are you guys? I am so happy to be here again. This is my second year in a row doing this panel. If you missed it last year, don't worry, I'm going to be covering a lot of the same topics. And if you were here last year, I have done a lot of updating on this panel, and it's a lot better now. So the main reason I want to do this panel is because I have a very strong passion for tabletop gaming. It was a strong part of my family for as long as I can remember. And there's a really bad problem with, there's a very limited resource in tabletop gaming right now, and it is finding a game master. A lot of people are too intimidated or just don't want to be the one to do a game master because they think, oh, it won't be as fun as being a player. And so that's why I wanted to come here and share what it's like to be a GM in Equestria. Now, if you don't know what a GM is, it stands for Game Master, the ruler of the game. And they are literally the ruler of the universe, more powerful than Celestia and Luna combined, because they control everything that happens in the universe. Everything that goes on around the players is completely created from the head of the Game Master, or from a written book that they follow. Usually, a person who's a game master has at least played the game that they're game mastering, or had some experience with tabletop gaming before they hop into game mastering. This isn't necessary, but I strongly suggest playing a tabletop game before you game master, so you can sort of get a feel of what you want to know when you're a player, so that way you know what to translate over to your players as soon as you're ready to be the game master. I want to start off with some basic rules and guidelines that can follow into any tabletop game and not specifically My Little Pony based ones. The first rule that I think is the most important rule in tabletop gaming is planning. You don't need to spend hundreds of hours a month just to plan for a game, but it's good to set aside a few hours each week before a session just to plan out, okay, here's what I think the players are going to do, and here's this town that I've built, and here's everything I want to be in the town, and all the important characters that are in the town, and the shops, and the homes, and how big it is. It's important. It's just important to set aside time to make sure that you'll be ready for any for the entire session. Now, that is completely negated by rule number two, which is be adaptable, because players never do what you think they will, no matter how much time you spend planning, no matter how much predicting you do of, okay, if they don't do this, they'll do this, if they don't do this, they'll do this, they will find something completely off the wall to do, and that it'll completely surprise you. So it's important to be ready to accept a very out there suggestion that someone throws and then follows through with, because as the game master, it's your job to be ready and to move the game along at a smooth and flowing pace. And I would say probably rule number two is a lot more important than rule number one, because being able to improv on the spot will make your game so much more fun, because it'll make the players feel like they actually have an influence of what they're doing, because if they do something crazy that they think there's no way any real world would respond to this, and then you give them a response that makes sense and that works and that they like, your game instantly becomes 100 times better than any other game they've played. And the third most important rule is do not railroad. And if you don't know what that means, railroading is putting the players on a track and then pushing them down it and not letting them deviate at all. For example, it would be like telling a player, like a player saying, oh, I think we should probably kill this guy because I don't think he's on our side, and then you as the GM telling him, no, you think that he's a friend. That would be an example of railroading, and that's something that can destroy the experience for players, because it just isn't fun. It takes away the choice and takes away the beauty of tabletop gaming, which is that anything is possible. And rule number four is, it's not a video game, and don't treat it like one. A lot of even open world video games are still very limited in what you can do and what you can say, the best way to reflect that is by making everyone have a thought. Every random person they talk to, everyone that they see actually matters, and they're not just, oh, enemy number four that I'm just going to cut down. You know, giving them a backstory, giving them a family, adds an incredible depth. Even if your players never look into it, they'll know in the back of their mind that it's there, and it creates a depth and an understanding that binds the player so much stronger than it will bind them to a video game. And those are some of the most important rules. And I don't want to. Throughout this panel, I'm going to try to avoid saying rules, because as the GM, your word is law, and you have the final say on everything. It doesn't matter what the rule book says. It doesn't matter what your players say. You have the final say in absolutely everything, because you control every atom in that universe. Now, of course, we have rule books, or as I like to call them, guidelines. I listed only a few rule books that I have personally used, and I've highlighted Pony Finder because they are here in the vendor hall selling their books, and they are incredible. They put in so much time and effort, and the art is phenomenal. I strongly suggest you go there, and if you can afford it, buy the core rule book and play it with your friends. And so what I want to say about rule books is they are extremely convenient, and they make your tabletop experience so much more expedited, because it handles all the not fun stuff, all the calculations, all the writing out item lists. You don't have to do that because it's in the rule book, or creating characters in the rule book. And the most, as a GM, you want to spend time looking and reading the rule book you want to use. You don't just want to find one with a pretty cover and nice art. You want to really read through it and make sure that it's fleshed out and that it'll work. And not only that it's good, but that it works with you and your players and fits their playstyle. Because if it doesn't fit your playstyle, it doesn't matter if it's the best system in the world. If it doesn't work with your players, it's not going to work. So, as a GM, it's your job to go through the entire rule book. And yes, I mean the entire rule book. And it can be very, very tedious, but it makes the game 100 times better. And by going through it, you'll have a general idea of where all the rules are. So if you forget one, you'll be like, oh, I know that. That's somewhere in chapter 4. Let me open up to chapter 4. Okay, here's the rule on healing. And that makes your player's process much more expedited, much more fun, because you're not spending time looking through the rule book, spending minutes to hours in every session, wasting time trying to find this one specific rule that has now been indicted. For example, grappling in D&D, the most complicated thing in the universe. And every time I run a D&D campaign, someone's like, I grab him. And every session I'm like, ugh. Because I can never remember the rule, because it's so complicated. But I remember where it is, because I've read the rule book, and I can open it up and say, okay, you're holding on to him, so roll strength. So I strongly suggest reading through the entire rule book, because then you have an idea, oh, what items would be in this shop? Well, I remember seeing battle axe in page 28, so I'm going to throw a battle axe in there. And it also helps your players, because your players are most likely just going to skim the rule book. And that's all they really need to do, because it doesn't really apply to them as much as it does as to the GM. Because the GM, you know, they change the rules. No rule book will be perfect to you. And as the GM, you can change it. No one's going to come into your house and say, no, this is how I wrote it. This is how you have to play it. No, the guy who wrote Pony Finder isn't going to be like, come into your Skype call halfway through the session. Actually, the rule is you can only heal 2 points a turn. No, he's... If he did, I would like just kick him out of the call. So as the GM, I try not to call it a rule book. I try to call it the guidelines, because everything is manipulable. You can change the rules to fit your personal setting, because nothing's going to be perfectly built to what you have in mind. And it sucks, but it's true. But that's why it's so great, because you can just, if you find something you don't like, it doesn't have to be that way. And of course, we're going to delve into more of the My Little Pony aspect of being a GM. And I want to start with races and what you have to keep in mind when each of your players plays one of these races, or if you're using them as an NPC. And we're going to start with what most people assume to be the worst race, which is Earth Ponies. I strongly disagree. Earth Ponies are very underrepresented in the magic that they carry. All types of ponies have a lot of magic in them, and it's just shown in different ways. Through Pegasides, the ability to fly. Unicorns, duh. And in Earth Ponies, it's their knowledge of nature and their strength, their hardiness, and their attunement with nature. And a lot of GMs just throw that out and say, oh no, they're just hornless unicorns, wingless pegasi. And I don't like that, because then no one, who wants to play a wingless pegasi? That takes out all the fun of the pegasi. But what's great about Earth Ponies is how strong they are and how smart they are when it comes to nature. It's important as a GM to encourage at least one of your players to play as an Earth Pony, because it brings such a variance to your game, because they don't have magic. They can't fly over the chasm that is blocking their way. They can't teleport out of this combat. They have to stay and fight because they have nothing else to do. But because they have to stay and fight, they're much more tanky, and they can take a lot more hits than a unicorn could or a pegasi could. They can stay in the fight a lot longer, and they can fight harder than others can because of how much strife they've had to go through without having wings or magic or telekinesis to make their lives easier. They've worked hard their entire lives to get just what unicorns can get by going, oh, I'd like some flowers, so here's some flowers now. So it's important to remember that Earth Ponies aren't weak. They're not lame. They're not as fun. They're just as much fun, especially if you like being the barbarian. And of course, unicorns. Everyone wants to play a unicorn, and I guarantee if you run a game in the My Little Pony universe, someone will play a unicorn. I guarantee it. And wizard represent. All unicorns have the innate magical ability of telekinesis. This is something very easy to keep in mind through your entire game, but it makes you keep in mind how far away small objects are. It's like, oh, you fired that arrow 20 feet away, it landed about 35, so can they reach it with telekinesis? Probably. So it's important to keep in mind where small objects are that telekinesis can be reached with for the unicorns, because they will take advantage of that ability, because who wouldn't? It's... Exactly. Pumpkin cake can do it. You can. The most important thing to keep track of with unicorns is their spell book. Many unicorns have a very specific skill set lined in with their cutie mark, you know, like cooking or fighting. But of course, you have people like Twilight Sparkle, whose special ability is magic. And you need to be able to remember not all of their spells, just in the general idea and the most powerful ones. For example, you don't want to forget that your unicorn player has teleportation, and you try to put them in a cage, and like, all right, I'm just going to teleport out the cage. You're like, I wrote a 30-minute puzzle. Because unicorns are very good at circumventing puzzles. Exactly. Magic is cheating. And it's important as the GM to remember, okay, how can I make a puzzle that can't be magicked away? And what I think is the most interesting, what My Little Pony adds over all other tabletops, is the Pegasi and the Griffins. I'm going to go over these two kind of in the same, since they're both basically the same ability, but one has hands. Pegasi add such an interesting development. I originally didn't think much of it, but it actually makes you think a lot more than you would just playing regular D&D or Pathfinder, because it adds a third dimension to your game. 99% of the time in a regular tabletop, they're going to be on the ground and walking upstairs at most to change their third dimension. But when you use Pegasi, you're constantly adding that third dimension. It's not just, oh, maybe once a session, I'll need to think about the height and the differences of what planes they're on. But with Pegasi, they're always flying, almost always, unless they're Fluttershy, of course. What I found is an easy way to keep track of when Pegasi are flying and how high are coins. Most of the time, if you're playing in person, of course, most of the time you'll be using tokens to keep track of where you are on a certain battle map, whether or not you have a battle map. But what you can do is you can just take their token and put a certain amount of coins on it. If they're flying low, each coin could be like 5 feet. If flying high, 10 or 20. And that way it's like, how high are they again? So you got 3 coins. Okay, they're 15 feet in the air. That gives them a ranged bonus of 5%. And it can be very, very difficult to remember to keep in mind of, oh, Pegasi can just fly over this problem. I can't make this a problem because they'll just pick up their friends and fly over one at a time. So it's so you have to think, okay, how can I make this situation hard even though they have someone who can just fly over the problem? For example, during one of my campaigns, I had a river they had to cross. It was impossible to walk across. It was too deep and too fast. So the Pegasi would carry them over one by one. But as soon as they dropped them off, they were attacked by timber wolves. So they had to make a choice. Who are we willing to leave there to fight the timber wolves while I go get them back up? And so it made it a much more complicated choice. And simply flying didn't solve the answer. And something, and just as a tangent for griffins, don't forget they have hands. I have that problem all the time. Because 90% of the time, you're either thinking they're either telekinesing it or they're using their mouth. And I remember I had a griffin in my game, and they were holding, I think it was an axe or something, and they're like, I'm going to shout to my friend to come give me back. I was like, you can't talk, you have an axe in your mouth. And they're like, I'm a griffin. I was like, oh, shoot. You can always... there are a lot of other races, like, you know, zebras, diamond dogs. And with zebras, it's mostly role-playing, except for potion making. Of course, we don't know if all zebras are potion making, but a lot of the campaigns and rule books paint the zebras as alchemists. So most of the time when you play as a zebra, you're going to be using herbs. So as a GM, you'll want to keep in mind, okay, what could they find in this area? Are we in a home where they'll find nothing? Or are they in a home that used to belong to another zebra, so they'll find everything? Are they in nature? What can they find here? Are we in the Everfree Forest? It's important to keep in mind what herbs and elements that they can find that they need to make their potions. There's also minotaurs. There's a lot of races, and I can't cover them all because there's just too many. Zebras do not need to rhyme all the time. That's just a Zecora thing. Don't enforce that on your players. They won't have a good time, I promise. Neither will you, because you'll be like, did that rhyme? Do I have to cancel that speech because it didn't rhyme? Exactly. It's fun for 5 minutes. And it's like, can we not do this now? A lot of players, and this is kind of a problem I've had for a while, a lot of players want to play as alicorns. As a GM, I suggest to you to not allow your players to play as an alicorn, because they are so incredibly powerful, and it requires you to keep in mind so much, because they have such incredible magical ability and they can fly. And it just becomes too complicated to keep track of. And it also makes them overpowered, which makes your encounters, and if you make your encounters weaker, or not weaker, if you make your encounters stronger, the other players in the party won't feel like they're contributing as much and no one's having as much fun. I've done campaigns where they were both Celestia and Luna in early Equestria, which was one of the best campaigns I've ever run. So if you make a campaign with the idea that you're going to have one alicorn or all alicorns in your game, absolutely go for it, because it can be a lot of fun to allow your players to have that much power. But you have to remember, I have to make these encounters more difficult, but not ridiculous. And so after, you of course have player characters. These are the characters your players are playing, the ones they create, the ones they are, the ones they love. Most of the time in the rulebook, there will be a guideline for creating characters. And as a GM, I strongly suggest, I keep saying strongly suggest, but I really, really strongly suggest this, that you make a few characters, maybe just some important NPCs or some throwaways. But to go through this a few times and to understand how characters are created will make the character creation process extremely faster for your players, because they'll be like, okay, what do I do next? And you're like, oh, this is exactly what you do next here. Then you calculate this, write these numbers down, and you're done. And of course, player character creation always takes time. It can take from 1 hour to four. So it's important to plan a session zero, where your players can just create their characters and talk about them and see what they want to do, so that way they'll all have an idea of who they're going to be and how they're going to mesh. And in session zero, it can be fun to allow them to meet together, maybe in like a tavern setting or an inn or something, just to let them talk as their characters, to get into the mood and get into the idea of what exactly they're doing. And of course, that brings us to the party, the entire party. as a GM, you're going to want to make sure you know who everyone is in your party and what role they play. Because, of course, you have every... You want to try to avoid making someone into the main character, but someone always becomes the main character. It just is sort of a thing that happens. It's usually one of the main damage dealers, usually a melee character. But don't ever forget about the healers, about the alchemists, about the background. Because they're not the background. They're still just as important as your so-called main character. So you'll usually have a composition of a damage-dealing melee, a ranged, a healer, and then a miscellaneous, which is usually a wizard or something like an alchemist. And I suggest keeping your party to four or less. You, of course, can go over, and it can still be a lot of fun. But things get very, very... I've personally noticed them getting very hectic and very hard to control after four. Once you're up to five, you have a lot to keep in mind. It's still possible, but you have so much to keep in mind, and you have so many things to keep track of. It just expedites your problems to a much higher level. You want to keep in mind, and you want to encourage players to play the healer. You want to encourage them to play the support, because no one wants to be the support. And that's unfortunate, because the support is undeniably the most important character in tabletop gaming. Because they keep the main characters alive, because you can create encounters that are very, very deadly. And if they don't have a way to consistently heal every other turn, or every turn sometimes, then they just won't be able to survive too long in your expansive dungeons or your dangerous Everfree Forest. Oh, we'll do questions at the end. Because they think it's so unglorious when really playing, as I play the support usually when I'm a player, I find I get thanked the most. I'm the one most looked after, and I'm especially usually the most important when we're not in combat as well, because I'm usually the high charisma healer who's, oh no, you know, my friend is hurt, can you come help him? And it's like, of course, let me heal him up. And it's so unfortunate, it's so very unfortunate that healers have been painted in this light of non-heroes, because they're really the heroes. The heroes are the ones who aren't murder hobos. Healers prevent your party from becoming murder hobos, because you don't want to let your party become murder hobos. And if you don't know what that means, murder hobos are people who don't question anything and kill all of the things they come across. In My Little Pony, that's very misrepresentative of what the show's about, and you don't want your players to become murder hobos in something about My Little Pony. Because it's all about friendship and talking and figuring out problems without fighting. But of course, sometimes things devolve into fighting. And it's okay. That's okay. A lot of things are built around fighting in tabletop gaming, and that's a lot of fun. We'll do questions at the end. As a GM, my favorite thing is NPCs. In the world. That is my favorite part of tabletop gaming, because I feel like I'm a player when I make NPCs. And you feel like you're 10 players or 20 players at once, because you have so many player or NPCs to keep track of, because your players want to talk to them. Your players want to interact with NPCs, because that what brings your world to life. Video games are very limited due to limited voice acting, because voice actors are very, very, very expensive. And so they'll usually only have like three voice actors voice like 100 generics, as it's called in the gaming industry. In D&D and in tabletop gaming, it doesn't have to be generics. Everyone gets a story, everyone's important. And that's why I suggest really fleshing out a small number of NPCs in towns, or that they'll come across as a traitor, or that they'll see, like that they'll want to help, because, oh no, my sister went off into the Everfree Forest, can you go find her? I love NPCs so much, because it really, that's where your world comes to life. Without NPCs, the world would be boring. There'd be no one there and only monsters to fight. Like, oh yay, we fought monsters, for what? There's just more monsters. We didn't save a town, we didn't save someone's, like, daughter, we didn't actually help anyone but ourselves. And, you know, that brings down the experience. When you have someone saving someone else and they feel like that they're a real person that matters, it just becomes a much more important experience for your players and makes it a lot more fun for them. One of the hardest parts in regular tabletop gaming, non-pony tabletop gaming, is naming characters because you run out of names. And you're like, oh, I can't. Michael is his name, and they're like, Michael, you—that was the name of 20 people 5 minutes ago. It's like, no. But what's awesome about My Little Pony is it's like sunshit shimmer, sunset shimmer, sunset shimmer, and twilight sparkle, and rose luck. It's so easy to come up with names in My Little Pony, and you have all these name generators on the internet. There's one I can't remember the name of where you can like, oh, they're like an ice healer, and then it's like, oh, icy sun, I don't know. But of course, you get something a lot harder when it comes to My Little Pony and NPCs, and that is cutie marks. Giving your NPC a cutie mark instantly makes them 100 times more interesting than an NPC without one, because it defines them. It shows you their struggle as a person, as a pony, to find what they were meant to do, and they found it. They got very lucky, and they found what they were supposed to do, and they found their special talent. And by telling that to your players, you're giving them a life as a full, as a young adult, as an adult, and what they've done, you can predict what they've done their entire life just through their cutie mark. And by doing that, it creates such a strong backstory compared to, well, not giving them a cutie mark. But of course, not giving them a cutie mark can be just as interesting. Because if something is a blank flake and is an adult, it's like, wow, how have they not found their cutie mark yet? And that could be an entire campaign in itself, is trying to help a pony try to find their cutie mark. And of course, you have another good one, which is monsters. The most important part of tabletop gaming, the monsters. Because if there's not something to fight, why are we here? Why are we playing this game if there's not something to fight? For friendship, for fun, of course. But why not add on to friendship by adding monsters? Because if you're trying to save someone from a well, that's incredibly noble. But if you're saving someone from a well that has a hydra, twice as noble. And then you realize it's actually three times as noble because they have another head now. Oh, now it's four. Someone help. creating monsters can be very hard, and it can be very easy depending on what rulebook you're playing. A lot of rulebooks will have something like the D&D Monster Manual, which is great because it's like, oh, boom, copy-paste this monster here, boom, copy-paste this monster here, and now it's interesting because they have new monsters and it's on the fly, ready to go. But if your rulebook doesn't, you'll have to spend some time setting aside, okay, what's their armor, what's their health, what abilities do they have, how much damage can they do? And it can take a lot of time to build your own monster, but it is so worth it because when your players fight a monster that's original and that you made up, they get to feel something that no one else will get to feel while they're playing. And it's an intimate experience, and they'll feel powerful when they defeat it because it's something that's never been seen before, and we defeated it. There was no written book on how to defeat this, like the gelatinous blob, which is back away. And they'll feel smart, and they'll feel important. And by using your own monsters, it's better than the copy-paste, but it's a lot slower. So of course, you're gonna wanna use the copy-paste. And the copy-paste aren't bad, because they're still incredible monsters, and there's a lot more art around the copy-paste than there are around the around the ones you created. But of course, your campaign doesn't have to have monsters. It's not a requirement to have fun in D&D, or tabletop gaming, to have monsters. I have played long My Little Pony campaigns with no monsters, no fighting, and all we did was run around and help people, like rebuild things and just talk to them and spend time in towns, and we still had so much fun. So you don't have to have monsters, but it's fun to include them. And this is why I love Pony Finder, is because you can take monsters straight out of the D&D Monster Manual and put them in, because most monster manuals are not gonna be very, you know, exclusive to humans. You know, skeleton, pony skeleton. Elf, pony elf. Easy conversion. And of course, then you have dragons and gelatinous blobs and demons. None of those are specific to humans, and they can be easily translated over into the My Little Pony universe with very little work. Exactly, gelatinous blob smooze. Now, of course, something no campaign is good without is the story. And it's also, in my opinion, the hardest part as a game master. But the even harder part of the story is the very first session, the hook. Why are we doing what we're doing? Why are we fighting for this town? Why do we care what we do? Why can't we just sit at home like children, like we always have for our entire lives? Why is today so important that we get dragged out of our homes to go on an adventure? And there are so many resources online to help you write a hook. And of course, you don't have to write it. There are so many online that you can just copy paste one into your campaign and no one will really notice because it's highly unlikely they've played it before. Maybe it's just cider season and they just want to go find some cider and there's none at Sweet Apple Acres. So Dash is like, we got to go to Canterlot and get the best cider of all time. Of course, the beginning, you want to try and hide details of your long-term plan for the players, because when you let them slowly discover things about your story, they'll feel involved, they'll feel smart when they're, oh my gosh, I can't believe we didn't realize that so-and-so was actually the bad guy. Because this is the part that engages your players, this is the part that makes them want to play next week. This is what makes them want to be their own game master and start their own game. It's like, that was such an awesome story, I hope I can write one that good someday. And what I love about tabletop gaming, I love to write. I love writing. But I hate novelized writing. And I have so many great ideas that would fit in a tabletop campaign that I can't put into a book because I can't write like that. And you can, as a game master, you can just put in general ideas and your players will take it from there and make it into a much more specified story and make it into something beautiful when it was something just kind of like, okay, they'll start out in town and someone will be like, hey, can you help my daughter? And then from that, a story forms because of your players. And you don't have to put in hours of writing. That's such a strong misconception of being a game master, is that you have to spend hours and hours and hours writing the story. It's not true. All you've got to do is write enough to start the day. If you write enough to start the day, your players will take it from there, and improv is very important for this. This may not work for you because I have taken many improv classes in my life. And I think that as a GM, if you can, find an improv class nearby. I'd suggest taking at least one class because it can bring your skills as a storyteller to the next level. Because if you can think on your feet of what happens next in the story when you couldn't have predicted what was about to happen, for example, players like befriending a mind flayer and helping him instead of just murdering him to death. Critical Role. when you're able to adjust the story on the fly, it makes the players feel important in the world. It takes them off the track. When they make their own decision that you didn't plan for and you go with it, that's what really sets apart video games and tabletop gaming. Because a video game, most of the time, no matter what you do, there's still only so many branches they can have, and you're still on a track. In tabletop gaming, there's no track. You're on foot hiking up a mountain that was never been hiked up before. And as a GM, it's important for you to create that mountain, to create the path that they can take. But of course, leave it open for them to do the hard side. Let them climb up if they want to. Let them go off the beaten path. Let them be the non-heroes. Let them be whatever they want to be. I've had campaigns where I was a blacksmith, and that's all I did. I didn't go out, have adventures. All I did was sit and sell people swords. And they had adventures, and they came back and would tell me of their adventures. But because my GM let me do that, it made that experience unforgettable for me. He didn't force me to leave the blacksmithy and become this fable-told hero. I was just a nobody. But it was still one of the best games I've ever played because I had a choice. And when you give your players a choice, it really sets it apart from any other type of entertainment, from books, from movies, from video games, from everything. It's in my opinion, better than any other form of entertainment. You have sessions. Usually you'll have sessions. Weekly, bi-weekly, daily. I've played games daily. It was not a good idea, but it was so much fun. And as a GM, you'll want to be able to end these sessions on a high note. But that doesn't mean a good thing happened. There are three, in my opinion, three great ways to end a session. on a high note. We just beat the boss, we got all the loot, and we got all this new armor and all this new stuff, and it's great, and I can't believe it, and I can't wait to come back next week so we can use it and sell this stuff so I can finally buy this goat. Of course, that makes your players want to come back because they feel successful. Like, oh, let's go be more successful. Let's do something even more awesome because we are already so awesome. There's nothing to limit us. And the number two way to end a session is on a low note. When your players feel defeated and beaten and just completely destroyed, that makes them want to come back next week. That makes them want to start again, try harder, do better. And an example of this was, I had players, this was a regular D&D campaign, I had players who I had players who had just met with the final boss, like halfway through the campaign, they'd caught him off guard, and they were destroyed by him. One of them had died, and the rest were very mortally wounded, and the main boss was like, all right, bye, and he just walked out. And they felt defeated, and I ended the session there because I knew that if I ended it there, they couldn't wait to get back and prove to him, prove to the final boss that they weren't worthless, that they weren't weak, that they were strong and powerful and could fight anything still. They weren't going to be defeated just because they were defeated once. The battle's over, not the war. And the number one best way to end a session is a story cliffhanger. Because this gets your players thinking about the game the entire week. I had a story I was very, very proud of. This was a few years ago. I was playing a Dungeons & Dragons campaign where the main antagonist of the game was the United States military in the year 6016 after a post-apocalypse. I had a session where I ended it. They had an agreement to meet with an officer, from a delegate from the United States military, and they got there and they were about to talk to him, and the first thing he did was he pulled a gun on them, and they had not seen a gun before, and I ended it there. And for the entire week, I got texts and calls. What's gonna happen? Come on, can't you just tell us what he's gonna say? Don't you have a plan? I was like, of course I have a plan. I'm not gonna tell you. You'll have to wait. See you Saturday. Exactly. And that is the number one way. But you don't want to do that every session, because then it ruins the fun of cliffhangers. You want to do it 3 times a campaign. That's usually how many times I have planned cliffhangers, like really good cliffhangers, because then it keeps the players on their toes. They're not like, okay, well, we'll just have to wait till next week to find out. Because that's not fun when you don't know everything all the time. Because sometimes you want to let your players know everything, or at least think they know everything, because they never know everything. Oh, sorry. The last point I want to touch on about the story is the ending. Ending a story is the second hardest part, because the hardest part is starting it. The hardest part about ending it is the best way to do it. It always seems like there's a new best way to do it. And you'll always think, oh, wait, this is better than what I had planned. Let me rewrite the ending. But there's no better ending than whatever you give to your players. They're going to love, as long as they've had fun, because it's the journey, not the ending, that they've had that matters. But when you give them the ending, that lets them close the book, that lets them reread it and enjoy it and finally have that moment of satisfaction. We've saved the world, we've saved the planet, or maybe we just got our cider. And that ending can mean the world to players if you execute it right. And it's important to delay that session by a week and spend extra time writing the ending. I have done that many times because I think every ending needs to be well written. You need to take your time and think, really, what's the best way, really? Not just because I think it's best now. What is the best for the players? Because that's why you're being a GM. You want the players to have the best experience they can on top of yourself as well. You want to have the best time you can as well. But it's really about bringing you guys together, and when you end it well and end it strongly, then your players are all brought together and they'll really never forget each other. They'll always have had that session, that gaming session, every week where they would do this amazing story and they'll remember it for the rest of their lives. So it's very important to spend your time on the ending. But of course, before you write the story, you gotta know where you are. And before you know where you are, you gotta know when you are. And Equestria has a lot of time and a lot of places. I won't touch on everything, but I've got quite a lot I'd like to talk about. So of course we have the past, which is probably the second best time setting for Equestria, because there's nothing written about it besides like Discord and stuff. It's so open, and it could be so beautiful because there's so much to discover there, and it can be completely up to you as the GM, because it can't conflict with canon, because there is no canon. But you can still have fun as ponies, as unicorns, as pegasi, as griffins, and you can still have such an amazing time with your friends in ancient Equestria because of how untouched it is, of how beautiful, of how nature it is. You can throw dungeons in there, you can throw anything you want, because that's ancient Equestria. There's no rules here. You can do whatever you want, and that's the best part about old Equestria. What I hate about My Little Pony is what they've done to the Everfree Forest. In the first episode, it was made out to be this scary, intimidating, never to go in thing. And then like now Apple Bloom like walks in there to get fruit. And it's like, why? Why would you do that? So that's where I love to break canon. I love to send my players to the Everfree Forest and make it terrifying. Because it doesn't matter what time of day it is, it's dark. Or it doesn't matter what time of day it is, there's these small globes illuminating it in the worst ways. And the best part about the Everfree Forest is the complete unknown about it. It's so open if you let it be. If you let an idea come to you, as long as it's a natural, nature-based idea, it works. Because you can just put it in there, because the Everfree Forest is mysterious. No one knows what's in there. So if you send them in, they could fight anything. And they could fight nothing, and that could be worse. Because you have stuff like Poison Joke. That's awful. If you don't know Zecora, what are you going to do? You know, you could have an entire session, an entire campaign, based on trying to find a cure for Poison Joke, and that would be hilarious. I love the Crystal Empire so much. It has such a rich story, and I love it. And I'd love to base a campaign there. I haven't yet because I've been, I don't know, busy. I don't have an excuse. But it's such an incredible concept, and it's barely touched upon because it's just too far away for the ponies to visit every day. But if you as the GM could visit there every day, you could have crystal ponies living in the Crystal Empire who have to go find Sombra's old hideout and take him down. That could be an incredible campaign. It could be why the Crystal Empire disappeared, because that's not canon yet, I don't think, unless there's a comic about it I haven't read. That's not canon. And you could write an entire campaign about the rise, the fall, and the bringing back of the Crystal Empire and why all this stuff happened, because it's not canonical. And you can do whatever you want with it. It's so open and so beautiful, and I love it. Until Hasbro writes it, and then you're like, oh. The Zebralands are, of course, not a canon thing, but they have to be, right? Zecora had to come from somewhere. She's not just the one zebra in all of the world. But what we do know is that it's most likely a very tribal area because of how Zecora acts. And I love to put things in the Zebralands because it's different. It's very different from what most tabletop campaigns are. And it can be such a strong place for story because of the tribal aspect, the movement aspect. The animals that you can put in there are completely different from anything else that'll be in any other campaign. So if you can, send your players there. My favorite, probably my all-time favorite, oh no, there's one, this is my second favorite, Faraway Kingdoms. Because again, there's no canon. You can do whatever you want as the GM with this. Because there is no canon, there's nothing to reference, and there's nothing to conflict. You can do whatever you want with Faraway Kingdoms. And the politics are completely up to you, everything's up to you, and it can be this crazy democracy or this tyrannical dictator, but it could still be a beautiful place. And sending your players to a faraway kingdom lets them explore something that's not fleshed out, and you let them flesh it out themselves instead of just saying, oh, well, this is how it happened in canon, so that's how it's gonna happen here. Yep, called it. But in here, it's like there's no rules, and it's beautiful, and I love it. And this is my favorite, industrial mazes. Like Manhattan and the future, all of this incredible stuff to send your players in. And the reason I love it is limited vision, and the mystery. Because an industrial maze can tell a very strong story without any books. Because you can have skeletons lying around that tell a story. For example, in Fallout 3, in the sewers with the guy with the motorcycle with his head like hanging from the ceiling light, made me laugh every time. But with industrial mazes, you have so much space to play with, but it's actually not that much space. But because it's so, you know, you have so much vertical space, you have so many rooms that make it seem bigger, you can make your game a lot better without doing too much extra work. And of course, we have a very dark future. Or a bright one, it's up to you. But I prefer dark, because Fallout Equestria is awesome. out of all those rule books I showed you, the one I played the most was definitely Fallout Equestria, because it's very well fleshed out and it's a lot of fun. It's beautiful, it's fun, there's so much untold about it. All the story is completely up to you because it's the future. Nothing's been told about it yet. And you can do whatever you want with it. It's so free and so beautiful, and even if it's a dark future, it can still be bright. And of course you have anywhere your imagination will take you. I'm gonna skip survival because we're a little short on time. Balance is mostly taking care of rule books. I'm gonna skip this. We have oops. We are not perfect. As GMs, we make mistakes. It's gonna happen, I guarantee it. When you make a mistake, admit it happened, talk to your players, say, hey, I'm sorry, this actually didn't happen, so I'm gonna have to word of God it into this. And most of the time, your players will be accepting of it. If they're not, just talk with them and see what you can do to make it an acceptable experience for them. And one of the most important things, and one that's posted on online forums a lot, is dealing with out-of-game issues. When you have conflicts with a friend being, you know, not a friend, he's being a jerk, or someone's not having as much fun, the best way to deal with out-of-game issues, and for some reason no one thinks of this, and it's such an important topic to cover, is talk to them. All you have to do is talk to them. Just spend a little time and say, all right, well, what's wrong? Why aren't you having fun? Or why are you being such a jerk? Can you please just, like, tone it down a bit? And just talking to your friends about what's going on will solve 100% of any problems you have. So, and of course, the most important rule of all time. This is a rule. This is not a guideline. This is a rule. You gotta have fun. You gotta have fun. That's the best part. That's why you're doing this. You're doing this to have fun. I'm gonna go ahead and open this up to question and answer. Do we have a mic stand? Yes, okay, so just line up here, and I think we have a mic stand. It's coming, the mic is coming. There's a stand and a mic is coming. And if you don't get your question answered, or you wanna ask your question in private, find me after the panel, and I'm more than happy to answer any questions you have.
Oh, okay.
Oh, so thirsty.
Is this good? Okay.
Yeah.
So, I have never heard this addressed by any of the sources, and I want to look for advice. I always attempt to play as a GM who is also a player.
Okay.
How, are there any tips?
Absolutely. My number one tip is make them an idiot. That's honestly the best tip I have, is because as the GM, you have all the info. You know, you know exactly how this puzzle's solved, you know exactly what you want and know what the player should do. But if you make them an idiot, they can't make those suggestions. And that's where you can still play and enjoy, but you won't ruin the experience for your players by knowing everything. Exactly.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Oh, okay, too close. Sorry. Am I passing this to the next person?
All right. I'm not. It's not a foot away. I wasn't sure if this was you intended to cover this or could cover it, given it's mostly gaming and Equestria. But I was thinking specifically of crossovers with a human world in which Equestria is actually in there. The example I'm using is basically a fan fiction which put Equestria pretty solidly into the established D&D world of Mystara.
Absolutely. Do you mean like actual humans with the ponies or just, yeah, okay. Well, absolutely, you can do that. There's dimensional rifts. It's easy to write off a why, but it's what's more interesting is how they work together. And it's interesting because humans are weaker, obviously, by a strong amount because they don't have magic. You can absolutely do this, and it's just important to keep to make sure that if you're having someone play as a human, you don't want to count them out, and you want to make sure that they're given buffs and abilities and items that help them out to help them be equal to the ponies who have magic. You know, you want them to come from, you know, more technically advanced places so that they can have an advantage of technology or something like that. I hope that answered your question.
What's your opinion on perpetual games? I'm currently running a campaign. We're about session 23.
Perpetual games are awesome. I've had campaigns last years, and I will never forget them. I come from a family with Alzheimer's. I hope that these are the last things I remember because they're the most fun campaigns I've ever been in because the story is so strong, and you have very intense bonds with these NPCs and these players. I think long-term campaigns are the best way to go.
One thing that I like doing when I attempt to GM a game is to give each player character their own sort of mini story arc.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any advice on how to do that in the best way?
In the best way, I'd say make it involve everyone, if you can. If you want them to do it in the past, of course you have to do it just them, but if you can involve everyone, then it makes it everyone's story. Not because when you try to branch off, and it's great to do personal story arcs because it makes that person feel important, of course, and that's what you want with your players. You want them to feel important. But then the other players start to feel left out, even if you do their own story arcs. It just leaves other people out for that session. But if you find a way, and it's very hard to do because it is their personal story, but of course they're their friends and you want to bring them along and help. If you find a strong and smart way to bring along the entire party, it really changes the experience for not only the players who aren't included, but the player who it's about, because it makes their story intertwined now. Because if you try to separate their story and do a solo session, it breaks them off from the party and it breaks the party. But if you do it together, it just brings them closer.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
I was wondering if you could say more about Critical Role for the people that haven't seen it, because that is a very good thing to watch if you're...
So, Critical Role is a show, it's a D&D show that Geek and Sundry live streams every Wednesday, I think. And every Thursday. And it's an incredible show, and it's all these amazing professional voice actors, and they're all just having fun playing D&D together. If you haven't seen it, I strongly recommend it. All the episodes are on the Geek and Sundry YouTube.
All right, so I'm running a campaign and one of my players is currently being that guy.
Mm-hmm.
And he's role-playing completely differently from everybody else. He's like actively trying to break the story, and I'm wondering if you have any suggestions for dealing with someone like that.
Absolutely. If the other players are as against it as you are, I suggest bringing, like before one of your sessions when everyone's together, bringing it up and saying, hey, listen, you're being that guy, you gotta stop. And if he doesn't, if you talk, I'd suggest talking to him for a while, seeing why he's acting like this, and if your player, if no one's having fun, kick him out if he doesn't change.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, two questions. First one, what do you think of co-GMing? Because I've been running into the issue where I've been getting busy, but I have, you know, one or two eager other people who want to learn how to GM, and I haven't figured out a good system for co-GMing, so...
Okay, well, so I was actually... I usually do this panel with my friend, who I call the Master of Storytelling, and we call me the Master of Gameplay, because we will occasionally GM together, and he will work on the story completely on his own, and I will work on the gameplay elements. All of the combat is up to me, and everything about the story is up to him, because those are equal amounts of work. And by splitting it up like that, it instantly becomes stronger. And as co-GMs, you can have, when you're in combat, you can just split it down the middle, and he'll take two characters, and you take two characters, and you fight. Co-GMing can be really hard to do right.
Yeah.
I'm sure most people here who have tried it know that. But if you do it right, it's very... It brings a completely different experience to the players than if you just have one GM. Because you're spending a lot less time in the rule books, you're spending less time not playing because you have another person to help. So definitely just coordinate with them. Work with them, see what they're willing to do, see what you're willing to do, see what you both have time to do, and break up the work in an even way.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I have a question.
Go for it.
Do you add shamblers to Equestria?
What?
Shamblers from Quake?
I'm not sure what you're asking. What? I'm not sure what that is.
It's like, you know, the ones that like hit you with their claws and stuff.
You mean the diamond dogs? I'm confused to what the question is.
You know,
he's asking if you're familiar with shamblers from Quake.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I was wondering if you can add them to Equestria.
Oh, yeah, you can. I mean, as the GM, you are the god of the universe. You can add absolutely anything, as long as you make it balanced. You have to spend time adding new races to the world because they need to be balanced.
Okay, thank you.
You're very welcome.
Two questions.
Go for it.
I'm working on starting a campaign in Fallout Equestria's Frozen North. Mm-hmm. The Crystal Empire's, completely gone. Everything's snowy, as always. But I was wondering if it's possible to have Crystal Ponies as, their own race, and would you have any ideas on what, their bonuses would be, or would they just be sparkly Earth ponies?
Yeah, I played a campaign in the Frozen North in Fallout Equestria once. Since it's Fallout Equestria, what we did was we gave them a resistance to lasers. Because, they're crystals. Stuff.
Oh,
lasers
that's a really
bounce
good
off
idea.
Crystals. Yeah.
And the other question is, hypothetically speaking, you have a D&D party and everybody is lawful good, and then you have that one guy who's chaotic neutral. How do you
chaotic neutrals are very interesting because they're the I'll do what I want types.
Or sorry, not chaotic neutral, chaotic evil.
Oh, okay. Chaotic evil. Okay, that can be complicated. And sometimes it's best to just ask them if they're willing to change their alignment, but if they're not, it can be fun. It can be a lot of fun if you, all you need to do is just let him do what he does as a player because that's what his character would do. And of course, try to keep it in line. Don't let him say, oh yeah, I'm gonna blow up this school because he's with a bunch of lawful goods who will hopefully restrict him from doing evil.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Gotcha.
Okay, so I have a bit of a thing I want to throw out there and then kind of a question for you based on that, which is with players, one thing I've found is that if you're trying to get them to do things like play the support role, mm-hmm. one of my favorite things was pointing out, hey, you're boosting them by this much, which means this much of their attack bonus mm-hmm. is yours to claim, so you can claim that much of their kills. Mm-hmm. as your kill count. And so when my players who love to celebrate their kill counts at the end of the night pull together, the booster actually gets a higher kill count than everyone else.
Yeah,
do you have any other methods like that?
What I do is I do prevention of death counts. So you keep track of how much damage they've taken versus how much they've healed. And if they've healed more than they would die by, it's prevention of death, which I love. It's worth 10 kills. just count up how much... Let them count up how much health they've healed and see how many times they've saved a life.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Vote Red Eye 2016.
Last question, by the way, guys.
I have a question about game balance. Last year was my first time DMing Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition, and I found out a little later than I should have that one of my players has exceptionally high stats.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any tips for balancing encounters for that consideration, or should I just rebalance the entire party stats from the ground up because some people also have very high stats?
Don't rebalance the party stats because then people feel like they're being punished without reason, and that's not fun. What I suggest doing when someone has very high stats, most of the time I, as a GM, let it go. But if it's really bad,
it's really bad.
It's bad, okay, they're all 20s, or I would suggest It's really tough to deal with because you don't want to punish them unfairly for something they didn't do. But if you have to, bring down their stats. But make a story reason for it. Make them go through like a radiation bath that makes them weaker, or make them like get hit in the head so they're dumber or less charming. Or, you know, there's a lot of things you can do in-game to limit their abilities as a player. Or what you can do is you can bring up your other players for, like, you know, oh, he took a radiation bath, so now he's stronger. You know, there's a lot of things you can do to rebalance your party in the story so they won't feel like they're being punished for no reason, or because you also don't want to give them free stuff, because then they're like, oh, well, I'll just ask him for this and he'll give it to me. That's no fun for you. So yeah, find in-game reasons to either, if you have to, bring them down, or to bring the others up to match the power.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, thank you all so much for coming. I hope you have a great BronyCon 2016!